Good evening, this is Inquirer Live. I'm RK De La Cruz. And we are also live on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Our guest for tonight is none other than Representative Martin Romualdez, who is running for a seat in the upper house or a Senate seat. You may ask your questions via Fire Chat, Kakao Talk, Line, and Viber. Your initial statement, opening statement, Congressman?
Well, good evening, Arlene. Thank you so much for the invitation to be here at INQ Live, and I'm very, very honored to be invited here to speak out about my platform. And of course, I'm running for the Senate, and I'm from Tacloban City, and I'm running on a platform of Malasakit, or a compassionate platform, and I'd like very much to talk about it as this interview goes along.
Ang una ko sigurong tanong sa inyo, Congressman, eh, siyempre bawat kandidato, bawat partido ay tumatakbo based, of course, on the platform. Merong tema yan. And your theme is Malasakit. Ibalik ang Malasakit. Why that campaign? Why that slogan? Nawala ba talaga ang Malasakit?
Eh, sa tingin ko po, pagkatapos ng Yolanda, nakita ko po yung Malasakit ng mga tao. Yan ang po naging dahilan kung paano kami nakabangon sa Tacloban, sa Lalawigan, ng latest sa Yolanda-stricken areas. Yung pag-aalaga, pagtutulong ng Pilipino sa kapwa na nilang Pilipino at walang hinintay kapalit, yun po talaga ang nakita ko. That was the secret ingredient. That was something very natural. And that is what created this whole wave, like a storm surge of help, assistance, that brought us to where we are today, on the path to recovery and to rehabilitation.
So parang lumalabas, kung hindi nangyari yung Yolanda, you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be facing the nation and offering yourself as a candidate in the Senate. Kumaga parang it was a trigger point. Should we look at it that way? Na ito yung nag-compel sa inyo. This is the one thing or the one event that compelled you to decide, I'm running for the Senate.
Well, definitely after I went around the region. Okay, we did not limit our operations for the relief and the recovery just to the district. But we saw how badly needed more assistance and help was for our Region 8 or the Eastern Visayas. The programs and the projects were underfunded, and we felt that we wanted to have a representative. And we spoke among our leadership in the region, and they said, it's about time that we had a representative in the Senate. It's been 60 years, Arlene, since our region has been represented. And unfortunately, our region is the most challenged region financially, in terms of funding, and in terms of development. And it's no coincidence that without the proper representation, perhaps that is why we are not properly being attended to. And while we go back to the Malasakit, and I say, ibalik yung Malasakit sa bayan, hindi naman sa walang Malasakit, pero sinasabi ko lang, baka kulang. At Malasakit pa more na lang. Diba? We want to really push for it. Kaya yung nakikita ko po, yung Malasakit plus public service, yun talaga ang sinasabing serbisyo na walang wakas. Kaya kung walang Malasakit yung public service, ay parang trabaho lang yun. Di ba, madalas sinasabi, ay, trabaho lang to, di ba? Pero pag nakita mo talaga yung mga public officials, lalo na yung mga local, mga LGUs from the barangay chairman, kagawas, BHW, and even mayors and governors, 24/7 ang trabaho nila. That usually goes unrecognized. Yung nakikita lang natin usually are the irregularities or the anomalies, which we hope are fewer and far between. Pero karamihan po talaga na nagsisilbi ay talaga nagmamalasakit. And we want to celebrate this virtue. It's very, very Filipino. Kaya even the international journalists who came to visit us after Yolanda, they saw how the Filipinos from all over the country came to us, and they similarly followed when they got news. And we'd like to even thank even the Inquirer. Your organization did tremendous work in Tacloban, nonstop. I could see it for myself, and working tirelessly, quietly, but very powerfully, because you could see the sincerity. Kaya we celebrate this. We want to imbue this generation. Because alam mo naman itong bagong henerasyon, nakakalimutan na yung sinasabing mga bayanihan spirit. I do not know if you remember when we were much younger, yun talagang pinag-usapan yung bayanihan, di ba? Naglilipat bahay, mga kapitbahay, tumutulong sa paglilipat ng mga nipahat, eh, siguro
hindi. That's malasakit.
Yes. That's the malasakit of this generation. And it transcended. And then that's the thing that really shone through. And that's what even the international community said. They were saying, they salute the strength and the resilience of the Filipino people. And we drew that from the malasakit or the compassion, the empathy of our fellow Filipinos. We want to share that. We want to celebrate that. Because we feel that we don't have enough of it. And under this very, very pragmatic generation that we have, with all the, the advent of technology and how things have become very transactional, we want to go back and draw from that very innate, that inborn, that very Filipino spirit, because we saw that, and it's almost infectious. We want to spread it around, because we saw that that was the key to our recovery, and that still continues to be the key. And of course, I would like to be there, because there's still a lot of work. There's still a lot of work to be done, but we celebrate the spirit. We do this in this manner with the Malasakit theme and the platform behind us, and we hope that we can bring out the best in all of us so that we can uplift not just the region, but regions similarly placed in the Philippines.
Before I read the questions thrown by LINE, Viber, Firechat, Kakao Talk, and Facebook page of the Enquirer.net, what is the one image looking back about Yolanda experience that you can't erase in your mind, that you can't forget, that one image that compelled you, that one image that that pushed you to serve and pushed malasakit pa more, sabi mong ganon. Ano yung image na yun?
Well, as I went around the city amidst the death, the destruction, you could still see the humanity of the Tacloubanons, of the people in the area, trying to help one another. Everybody was traumatized. Everybody was a victim. But despite all of that, you could see Filipinos helping one another, lifting one another, literally, the dead, the wounded, the helpless. And that's really struck me. So initially, everybody was like a zombie roaming around. But then, you know, as soon as they were coming back to their own consciousness, nagtutulangan na eh.
Kasi there was destruction, and yet you were inspired by what you saw, yes, the humanity that you saw.
It's very easy to lose hope. Eh. But obviously, you know, we were brought up to have faith, no? Faith in God, faith in the humanity of the people. And it's shown through. Eh. And I like to look at that and emphasize that more than, you know, the shortcomings, the negativities. Of course, we learn from that. But at the same time, we celebrate the positive side of all of this. Because most of us says, why did this happen? In fact, I was saying, I am the representative, the congressman, of the most devastated district in the entire country, in the world's recorded history. We were visited by the strongest typhoon. I was even saying to myself, what did I do wrong, God, Lord? Because I said, this is almost impossible. The Secretary of State from the United States, Secretary John Kerry, said, and this was almost a month after Yolanda and we had done a lot of cleanup, says, Mr. Congressman, it looked like an atomic bomb exploded over your district. And talagang mukhang wala na, durog na durog, dapa na kami. And yet I said, yes, but we will rise. As they say, we will be like a phoenix rising from the ashes, and with everyone's help, we have. And we still continue to do work to further the improvements and to get our city, our district, our province, and our region back on its feet and running again, and to show everyone that lahat yung pagod nyo, lahat yung malasakit mo ay hindi na sayang. We want to respond because we elected, we chose not to be victims anymore because of just like the storm surge that came. There was also a storm surge of assistance, of help. And that's what really carried us through. So we like to share the experiences and the lessons learned on how to improve on the systems, policies, and how to craft laws to mitigate the effects of climate change, which brought about, obviously, Yolanda and what even we're experiencing now, That's why we even filed a bill to create a department for disaster preparedness and emergency management, because we have to honor those who didn't survive. That their passing was not for anything else, but we have to learn from that experience. Mm-hmm. We have to honor those by learning from the lessons, from the experiences, and how to make sure that this does not happen again, or that we mitigate the effects.
If it happens again.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, because of climate change, as you can see, the storms are getting more intense. Mm-hmm. Even right now, the heat is getting worse, mm-hmm. and it has devastating effects on our crops, on our agricultural sector, and on our people. That's why we have to be ready, and we have to be more proactive. Mm-hmm. And as I keep on saying, but we have to dig deep, and we should not just look at this and dismiss this as, ay, freak storm lang yan eh. Mm-hmm. Ay, hindi na yan, ano, hindi na yan maulit. Diba kasi parang dito eh, after New Year's we're all hoping ay, tapos na yung nakaraan, sana man itong taon ay wala nang ano, wala nang mga Yolanda, wala nang yung mga El Nino. But as you, I don't know if you remember, one year after Yolanda, our region was visited by Typhoon Hagupit or Typhoon Ruby. And that was also a very, very, very strong storm. But it did not hit Tacloban, but it hit Eastern Samar. Not as populated, but it had very, very devastating effects. So there was not as much media attention there. But nonetheless, these are the realities. The storms are getting more intense, so we must be prepared.
Babalikan natin yung panukalang batas niyo tungkol dyan sa viewer na gusto niyong itayo. No? But this question from Pacha via line is related to Yolanda. If you win a seat in the Senate, how can you stop the corruption of money in terms of donations during typhoons and natural disasters?
Definitely through this particular law, this bill. No, by creating a department or an agency, we will now afford transparency, because this department or agency will have a budget that will now be scrutinized by the Commission on Audit. There will also be an agency head or a department head that will now be accountable and responsible. So it will be easy now to trace where the funds and where the goods are coming from, going to.
Or who is not performing.
And who is not performing. There's an accountability. And so we look at the international best practices. So this bill that I filed was not a novel idea on my part. Mm. When I was in Tacloban, a lot of the aid agencies were there, and they were asking us, why don't you have an agency or department like in the United States, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or like in Turkey, the AFAD? These two agencies all came and visited us, because that's what they do. When they don't have their own calamities or typhoons to attend to, they go and visit other countries to learn from the experiences there. But by doing so, by having this, it affords ourselves that transparency. And even before this bill or this measure becomes a law, I would like to conduct an investigation in aid of legislation to determine what really went wrong. Where were the shortcomings? San tayo nagkamali? Para hindi maulit. That is why you legislate. Mm. And in so legislating...
Can you also push in seeking the answer to this question? Where did the funds go?
Exactly.
The donations go.
Exactly. Because at the end of the day, while Yolanda was the worst possible storm to ever hit any area in recorded history of the world, we also got unprecedented amounts of pledges. Mm-hmm. Pledges. The donations that come in come through pledges. They are pledges, but they have to be converted to actual monies delivered. But the feedback we got is that the amount of pledges were not actually converted, because the international community is still trying to determine what did we do.
Or where to give it.
Yes, mm-hmm. or where to give it. So it wasn't very clear. Mm. What we have right now is the National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Council. Mm. It is a coordinating body without a budget. Mm. They coordinate departments like the DSWD, the Department of Health, the DILG, the Department of Defense, and you have these cabinet secretaries like the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman. You have the DILG, you have the DSWD secretary as the vice chairpersons for preparation and for relief, etc. But these secretaries have their respective departments and portfolios with their own set budgets for their specific projects and programs. Faced with a Yolanda that is so devastating, we had to pass a supplementary budget and subsequently look for monies on how to fund this budget based on a post-disaster damage assessment. And by the time that this was properly funded, and it wasn't actually properly funded because we, to date, have only funded a third of the master plan. Nakakalimutan na, nakakaligtaan na. Events overtake us. There are other typhoons. So what I'm trying to say is that this coordinating council almost handles these situations like Yolanda on an ad hoc basis. Hindi yan nakatutok 24/7. Pag nandyan na lang yung bagyo, yayan, o yung kalamidad, magtitipon-tipon sila sa Camp Aguinaldo with the president, and then there's some media attention, and they just go around the table, oh, handa na kayo, handa na kayo. Oh, sige. After that, okay, they disperse and they go and go to the provinces and they do the similar thing, but they don't have a budget. Mm. And as you said, sino ba dyan ang accountable? Mm. Is it the Secretary of Defense, the Chairman? Sino ba? Kaya wala eh. Mm. So who do you turn to? Is it the DSWD, Vice Chair, the Secretary? Wala eh. Kasi it's a confusion.
At nakita niyong lahat ito because of Yolanda.
Yes. Mm. And so we borrow again from international best practices. We look at their protocols. In fact, given the chance when I'm in the Senate, we will go through all these protocols during the hearings. We will thresh them out. We will have hearings and we will conduct investigations on what happened so that we don't repeat the mistakes of the past. Kasi yun ang nakakalungkot eh. Kasi parang nakakalimutan natin yung mga aral na yung nakaraan, paulit-ulit na. Kulang naman talaga yung sinasabing malasakit. Kung gano'n na lang ang patakbo natin ng ating gobyerno. Kailangan talaga matuto tayo. Dapat yung mga karanasan natin, yung maaral, dapat matuto tayo at gamitin natin ito para sa itong mga panukalang batas na ilalatag natin, isusulong natin pag nasa Senado na tayo, with of course your help and your support. And we want to use these experiences, and as the representative of the region, drawing from the experiences and being a witness to all of this, I think I'm properly placed to push these measures and this policy forward and make it into a law so that we can save more lives, save more property, and save more futures.
Iwanan muna natin ang Yolanda. Ito naman ay tanong sa pamamagitan ng Facebook. I have a question, sir. Totoo po ba na inendorso na kayo ng INC? Official na po ba ito?
Well, it is true that I went to the Iglesia ni Cristo last week, and nagpapasalamat ako sa Iglesia ni Cristo, lalo na kay Executive Minister kay Eduardo V. Manalo, na tinanggap niya ako at hiningi ako ng tulong at suporta para sa kandidatura ko. Pero sa alam ko po, wala naman endorsement ang Iglesia ni Cristo. Yung alam ko, meron silang pasya. And I think this is an internal matter in the church among the members. I don't understand if this would be something that would be shared to the public or put in the front page of the Inquirer, but I think this is an internal matter. But of course, this support through the PASYA would be very, very important to me, because even the Iglesia ni Cristo has become very close to us in Tacloban, in my district, for they quietly consolidated over 1,000 hectares to create a new era township. And there, within that area, they have not only a very expansive housing program, they also have an agricultural program, they also have food processing, garments, manufacturing. Completo po sila dyan. They have created a township right next to Tacloban in the nearby towns of Alang-Alang and Santa Fe, within my district, no? So that's done a lot for our community, and obviously their membership will definitely increase multifold. So yung malasakit nila was not just their lingap or their relief and medical missions that even began before Yolanda. And so I want to also ask them for support, because I would also want, in my own way, to support them in their own initiatives, not just in my district, but throughout the country as a way of paying back. Kailangan ko, sukulin ko po ang ipinamalas nilang malasakit sa atin.
Another question. Do you think that we should reform our party system, perhaps adopt the dual party system of the United States of America?
That's a very, very good suggestion because as we see, the multi-party system can be a little bit confusing. And the migration from one party to the other is commonplace now. In fact, it becomes the partisanship or political party system is also based on personalities. For instance, if the president is of a certain party, you can see a migration towards that party. And when we have a new president after May 9, I can imagine that there will be a migration of all of these members of this party to the president, the new president's party. So we have to strengthen it. And under a bicameral system, a two-party system might be more appropriate, kagaya po sa United States of America. But when you come to a unicameral system or a parliamentary form of government that was actually contemplated as the 1987 Constitution was being crafted, and it narrowly lost by almost a vote of two, there was a swing vote, then a multi-party system in a unicam or a parliamentary system is more appropriate. Mas bagay dun. Pero dito sa bicam natin, yung dual na lang kasi magulo. Sa totoo lang, nakikita ko medyo magulo talaga. Kasi just to form coalitions, just to get a consensus, you have to go from one party to the other and try to get the support of them. And medyo nakakanda. No? It's exciting, but as I see to it, the party system stands some improvement. So.
Going around the country, ano yung nakita nyong kailangan talaga ng tao? I mean, syempre may mga lumalapit sa inyo, may mga niyayakap kayo, inaakbayan kayo. Pag kinakausap nyo sila, ano yung ibinubulong sa inyo? Ano yung sinasabi ng mga ordinaryong mamamayan na nakasalamuha nyo?
Pareho pala eh. After Yolanda, I thought that we were the only ones really in need of support. Lalo na yung mga Visayas, Mindanao areas, where the areas are a bit more depressed, no? Being the fact that, maybe as an archipelago, it's not as united or unified, no? The development is not as strong as we have in Luzon. Pero pare-pareho rin eh. The needs of the people are almost uniform. Despite the diverse dialects based on the regional areas that we visit, pare-pareho rin yung mga nangailangan ng tao. Just like you and me, sa umaga, they make sure that yung mga anak nila, okay ba? May sakit ba? So health is very important. Then they ask, have they eaten?
May pagkain ba?
So nutrition. Napaka-importante yung nutrition. Kumain ng mga bata. O papasok ba yung mga bata? That's the dream of every parent, na makakatapos yung anak nila sa eskwelahan. So these are very basic needs. Of course, they live in a house. In most cases, in the far-flung areas, in the rural areas, hindi masyadong maayos yung mga bahay nila. They're built of light materials. So, yung pababahay nila. Then, of course, after the children leave, ano ba yung kabuhayan nila? Now, in the rural areas, obviously, agriculture is the key. That's why even in the agricultural sector, we must invest heavily there because, as I've been saying, food security is national security. Sa halip po na itong sinasabing Asian economic integration, all the trade barriers will soon be lifted to allow this free trade within the ASEAN. So all the food products that we are importing, the basic staple, rice, will be coming in. As we see it, our agricultural industry is at a disadvantage because it's not getting sufficient support from the national government. Even in highly developed countries, the agriculture sector is actually supported and subsidized. So we need to heavily invest in it because, as I said, food security is national security. It might be more expedient right now to import rice from, let's say, Taiwan, Thailand, and Vietnam. ironically, all their technology, lahat galing sa atin, sa Iri. So we can actually do what they've done because everything has come from us. But again, it is the policy of the national government. What is it? Is it clear enough? Is it enough political will to make our country rice self-sufficient in rice? We can. It's all there. Kung baga kompleto tayo sa Ricardo, pero hindi nagagawa. We are still the biggest importer of rice in the region. And yet, it's a basic staple and commodity. We're very vulnerable if there are any troubles within the region because the bulk of our rice that we consume is imported. We should do it here. We can do it. We haven't. In fact, ironically again, we have fewer irrigated rice fields than there were 40 years ago. Yet our population has more than doubled since 40 years ago. So we have to invest heavily also in our irrigation systems. In fact, we should even do away and waive these irrigation fees that are being charged to our farmers. Papabigat na yan eh, kasi nahihirapan na nga. So even the NIA, we have to revisit that and see if that can just be absorbed by the national budget because we understand from the NIA what they intend to collect every year is 5 billion, yet they actually collect only 2.5 billion. But with the underspending that we see, there's still a lot of savings, and this could actually be easily absorbed, no? This almost the deficit of 2.5 billion. So the 5 billion, just waive it. You give a break to the farmers. Then on top of that, you invest heavily into irrigation. Then further to that, farm inputs, implements, post-harvest facilities, farm-to-market roads, farm subsidies, crop insurance. If you just go heavily into this, we could be well on our way to not just rice, but food self-sufficiency. And the time to start is now. It's never too late, but we have to start now because it's just getting very, very more competitive in terms of the trade barriers now being dropped or lifted, and now we will have to compete. But we have to get the government going. And so at least we will have to have the farmers supported and the agriculture sector supported as well.
Another question, kailan po ba ma-implement yung PWD law? Enforce na po ba ito, lalo na sa public transport?
Maraming salamat na binanggit mo yan. Kaya we're very, very proud na itong Republic Act 10754, which we are the principal author of, an act to expand the benefits for the persons with disabilities or mga tao na may kapansanan, now including the value-added tax exemptions on top of the 20% discounts on goods and services, like medical products, medicines, medical services, like therapy, doctor consultations, dental visitations, and of course, local transportation, as well as board and lodging and the restaurants and even the cinemas, plus an amendment to the National Internal Revenue Code that now affords a tax break to all of those who are helping or supporting PWDs. Meron ng tax deduction na up to 100,000 pesos per taxpayer, broken down to up to 4 dependents at 25,000. So, papaginhawa din sa mga tumutulong, nagmamalasakit din ito sa mga tumutulong nag-aalaga ng mga PWD. And actually, it's been already signed into law last month. So, it is now effectively a law. The Department of Finance and the Department for Social Welfare and Development are crafting now the implementing rules and regulations. And in fact, I have conducted a few national consultations in Cebu, in Pampanga, and we're planning on doing another one in Mindanao very soon, maybe after the elections now, so that we can give more inputs to the IRR committee or DSWD and the DOF. So basically, we just want to put the PWDs at par. Tinatapat natin yung mga benepisyo sa senior citizens. In fact, I was also the principal author of the PIDAW law, or the Persons with Disabilities Affairs Offices, that will help in the administration of this law. Just like with the senior citizens, they have the OSCA or the Office of the Senior Citizens Affairs that helps administer, and they liaise with the local government so that there'll be a PIDAW officer in every city, in every municipality, and even the third, fourth, fifth class municipalities, at least a focal person. So to make sure that the law will be properly adhered to. At yung tama yung sinabi mo, actually, we have already have a law for the handicap access, which is not being properly observed. Kaya baka kailangan we have to amend this and we have to put some penalty provisions for those who are not observing this. Because nakakalungkot kasi mismo our national government for our public transportation system like our MRT, LRT, that already have facilities for the elevators and or proper access, eh, hindi na may maintain.
O kung sira.
Parati sira or nakatrangka kasi sasabi ng guard, ay, nakalock yan kasi yung mga bata, di ba? They just play with it. Pero kawawa tuloy yung mga ano.
Pero Congressman, ang ginawa niyo yung panukan ng batas na ito, syempre meron kayong pinagbatayan. Meron kayong, sabi nga natin, pinaghugutan. May inspiration kayo dito. Was there ano, a personal experience that led you to craft this bill, craft this law?
Just like every Filipino family, kung hindi meron kayong kapamilya na PWD or special child or tao may kapansanan, you know someone very close to you. In my case, my cousin was a special child and I only learned about that, you know, at a very, very young age. Kasi siyempre, diba, lalaro, habulan kayo. And then as we got a little older, hindi nakakahabol. And then we would ask all this wonder, bakit hindi siya nakakasunod sa mga laro natin? And that's only when I realized that she was a special child who needed special attention and special care. And of course, even special education. So right away, at a very young age, nalaman ko na there were special children who needed special attention. So I was very curious about it, and that when I was even a teenager, I decided to spend some of my time on vacations doing work with children who either had autism or were handicapped, no? Mm. To get a better understanding and also to help out, no? To see what we could do. And as I became a lawyer, I always said that, you know, we should actually have laws that will recognize this sector in society. And when I became congressman, I decided to turn this personal advocacy into an advocacy that is now part of the law. But this this law is just the beginning, no? We already have the Magna Carta for the PWDs. Tagumpay ito ng PWD sector to begin with. And nagpapasalamat ako sa tiwala nila sa akin, sa kumpiyansa nila sa akin to be their champion. And as I assure them, pag sinama nila ako sa Senado, I will be their champion and their voice. And we shall go further and to expand the not just the recognition and the attention to them, not just in these areas of exemptions on taxes, but also for special education, positive action in terms of employment, livelihood, also inclusion in the field health, to expand the field health, to include them. We have many advocacies within this sector that we would like to push forward, and I would like to be a part of that, especially if we are successful in our Senate bid, because it is a sector that has been overlooked, and it is probably in the culture just to set them aside or try to put them in the background. But actually, the PWDs are a very, very vibrant part of our society, a very important part. Talagang importanteng bahagi ng ating lipunan. Kaya pag sinuportahan natin at sila ay magiging masaya at masigla, they will be a very big contributor, not only just to our economy, but to our society.
You headed PhilConsa. Of course, PhilConsa stands for the rule of law. What do you think of Rodrigo Duterte's statements?
Well, I'm the president of the Philippine Constitution Association. Mayor Duterte is also a lawyer, so he's an officer also of the, as they say, the bar, no? And I think his statements are for effect, I think, rhetoric. Kasi otherwise, di marami ng kaso siya, di ba? I'm sure he would have already been prosecuted. So I think probably those are just strong statements. No. I think he has a lot of tough talk because I think he wants to instill discipline in his constituency in Davao. And I believe he's managed to do that because before his assumption to the mayoralty position in Davao, Davao was known to be a wild, wild west. But I understand right now, and I've been there, that it's quite peaceful. And even women and children are safe walking around the city at night. So the tough talk with also the firm application of the law particularly in law enforcement, has done well for Davao. And I guess that resonates. Kaya siguro maugong dito ang mga sinasabi ni Mayor Duterte, because political will, discipline, law enforcement are maybe much in need today. And that's why I think he's become very, very popular.
A related question on Duterte from Twitter. Bilang isang lawyer, ano po sa tingin ninyo ang totoo sa issue ni Duterte sa 211 million alleged bank deposit?
Well, I think the documentation, the evidence will have to support whatever allegations are being thrown at him. He has a lawyer attending to that. So if there are any cases that will be filed and any accountabilities and liabilities, let the courts decide. But other than that, I think we have to let these processes just take its place. But of course, there's a lot of media attention to it. And I think the mayor is a lawyer, and I think he'll know how to explain
Is he getting the right legal advice on this matter?
I think that's for him to to determine. But I think he knows what he's doing, and he's a lawyer, as I said. And I think he's got a very good legal team, I would imagine. And if these cases reach the court, then let him answer it in the proper forum.
Isa pang question again from Twitter. Are you in favor for same-sex marriage?
Well, we cannot actually legislate what is already there. We have already the family code that talks about unions, but what is really contemplated there are not actually same-sex marriages, no? So we would have to visit the family code. And all I've been saying when it comes to this is that the basic premise here is that we are all the same. Pantay-pantay mga Pilipino. Walang dapat makakalamang. So we should go for the anti-discriminatory law. And if there are those proponents who want that, then let these matters be debated on the floor. But what we have right now, what the family code contemplates are unions between a man and a woman. But if there are any amendments there too, then that's something that we can visit in the halls of Congress as these measures are brought to us.
Where do you stand on the issue of the Bangsamoro Basic Law?
We are for peace. We are for everlasting peace, not just in Mindanao, long-lasting peace. But at the end of the day, it should be an inclusive consultation. From what we could gather, parang nakakaligtaan ibang mga sectors, the stakeholders in the peace process. For instance, the MNLF are very, very noisy because they felt that they were not consulted. The members are left behind, the members of the Sultanate of Sulu. And of course, the Christian community that actually is the majority in Mindanao. So we feel, as this draft bill on the Bangsamoro was presented to us, not only were most of the provisions in conflict with our Philippine constitution, but parang hindi yata nagkonsulta sa ibang mga sectors. So we feel that not only should it be more consistent with our constitution, but there should have been more consultations, more inclusive consultations, para wala na lang mag-alma. At least pinag-usapan, sinama sa usapan, at yung output ay dapat inclusive, sinamahan lahat. Mukhang marami yata mga areas na nakaligtaan ng ating peace panel.
Kumbaga isulong, pero teka muna, pag-usapin muna lahat ng sektor. Again, from Twitter, sinabi niyo po na hindi pa tapos ang laban para sa SSS pensioners. Ano pong next step niyo tungkol dito?
Well, pag sinama mo ko sa Senado, isusulong din natin yan. Tinapos na nga natin yan sa Kongreso, naging batas na nga po yun. Pagkatapos na veto, nagulat kaming lahat. Kaya dapat na lang sana, bago na lang na yung veto, sana pinagsabihin naman kasi merong PLLO, the Presidential Legal Legislative Liaison Officer, meron dapat LEDAC, wherein the legislative and the executive meet, supposedly regularly, pero those meetings have been fewer and far between. Para malalaman din natin anong ang iniisip ng ating presidente and the members of the executive department in a more formal forum wherein the congressmen would have heard it for themselves at hindi lang sinabi lang sa iba. It would have been better if we were told in advance. That's why we were among the first who went for the override. But naubusan na tayo ng oras. the Congress session was adjourned as we were launching our override. That's why pag nag-umpisa naman yung 17th Congress, and when I'm elected, no, as a senator, we shall be pushing that, because at the end of the day, our senior citizens deserve the benefits that they all work so hard for as working members of the workforce, no? Mm-hmm. So the reasons why it was vetoed, I beg to differ with what they are saying. Our financial executives at the SSS should even be more active and find more innovative and creative ways on how to invest the monies there, mm-hmm. so that the actuarial studies would now indicate that there would be more
so
funding for that.
Respond to the needs, diba?
Yes, mm-hmm. And it's been some time now. Matagal na na hindi tinas yung mga benepisyo, at alam mo naman eh, tumataas naman yung bilin ng ating mga basic commodities, kaya talagang kawawa talaga mga senior citizens natin, at oras na talaga pabigyan naman sila. Magmalasakit naman tayo sa mga senior citizens.
From Viber, I think this is a related question. How will you empower the youth and at the same time give comfort and security to the elders? Through legislation, of course.
Well, through legislation, we have, of course, our Malasakit platform. One is, of course, giving free education, not only in elementary, not just through secondary or high school, but through state university and college. Arlene, alam mo, wala pang 20 billion dapat ay invest lang natin sa education. And this is actually the number one priority in the Constitution. And we will have a truly effective and free educational system for all those qualified from elementary all throughout college. Mm-hmm. On top of that, the realities are this. We also have to help our students, the youth, and not only just the youth, it'll even affect society with exactly what you're holding on to. We have to have better access to the internet. We have to increase, you know, faster internet service. We have to drop the prices because we are only faster than Afghanistan in our region. We are the slowest in terms of internet speed and the lack of bandwidth. That is why we suffer the most, because we have to wait the longest in buffering, ang tagal-tagal. Bukod pa yan, we actually pay the most. And this is a hamper. Kumbaga, sagabal to sa ating ano, edukasyon. Because as you can see, all our students now, they rely on the internet. Eh. Ini-email yung homework, di ba? O yung mga lectures, nala-live streaming na lang. Ito mismo, nala-live streaming na lang. Eh, mabuti na lang kung everyone has all the facilities like what we have here in the Inquirer. But this type of services, if spread throughout the country, will hasten, will enhance the educational attainment of all our students. And guess what? The utilization and increase of internet speed also has a direct correlation with our economy. You know that e-commerce is here. It is very active. With better internet services, even our economy will prosper. That's why we have to also invest heavily in that. And what can we do with that? We shall engage now all the players. We can call in the NTC. We can call in the players in the telecom industry, the Globes, the smart officials. And let's talk about how we can afford better services. How do we interconnect? What policies or measures should the NTC take to afford not just our students, but our whole society with better internet service? And that, once it is done, and with political will, and with a very firm drive, is easily achievable. Diba sinabi ko lang eh, yung mas mabagal lang sa atin, Afghanistan eh. And so the other countries are way ahead of us already, and yet we're paying the most. So we can actually streamline this, and we can afford our students with a better access to, the information superhighways.
What do you think of Mar Rojas' candidacy? May tanong dito from Twitter.
Well, he's the administration candidate, and I think that's his prerogative to run. And of course, he's the standard bearer for the Liberal Party. That's the administration party, and we wish him the best of luck.
Yung response niya during Yolanda, ito yung isa sa mga parang of course negative negative issues against him. sa tingin nyo, ano yung tawag nito, ano yung, kung meron man siyang nagawa na ano, na akma dun sa Yolanda crisis, what was it? Kung meron man. At kung saan siya talaga nagkulang?
Well, we rather not dwell on the shortcomings or on the things that could not have been done. Because in fairness, nobody could have prepared for this adequately. It's the worst possible storm. But that being said, we also have to learn from the lessons that politics should never raise its ugly head in times of calamities. Wherever it was coming from, it has no place in calamities, especially when it comes to preparation, relief, and recovery. These are the lessons we all have to learn. That's why we talk about malasakit. Basta magmalasakit tayo sa isa't isa, makaisa tayo lahat. Kung sino ka man, we can always overcome. So rather than dwelling on that, because we all know where we all came up short and how we can improve, and that's why we have these policies, we have these bills that we want to present when we're in the Senate, then at least the lessons learned will now be applied, and I think we would have overcome it.
What do you think of surveys? Surveys. Sinasabi ng iba, this is a form of mind conditioning, especially nearing the date of the election.
Well, surveys are as they are, no? Well, if you go to the medical field, they're like maybe X-rays or MRIs, snapshots of your condition at any given at any specific or given particular time. Now, without any outside forces or intervention, those will remain the same. But obviously, it tells you where you are. But at the end of the day, I guess if you're what you're driving at, the most important survey is May 9, the election. But at least candidates usually use their surveys to tell them where they are, where they're strong and where they're weak. And when it comes to mind conditioning, if some candidates elect or want to use surveys that they might commission on their own for whatever purpose, then you have to know what is the provenance of it. And moving forward, I think we have to also look at the possibility of also crafting a regulation on how to also have these surveys propounded and shared with the public, because at the end of the day, we want to give the public, and I think we would call on the media, like the Inquirer, to help us along on this line so that this mind conditioning that you said, or the abuse, the possible abuse of the survey or the polling system will not mislead the public one way or the other. But yes, anything that has some human participation is always subject to the frailties of the human needs or intentions or desires. That's why basta kasama dyan yung tao, obviously there can be, you know, but hopefully not manipulations to particular ends.
There's one question from Dijan Magbanwa o Bandera. Are you ready, Dijan? Paano nakatulong sa'yo yung pagiging independent mo sa candidacy mo? From Dijan Magbanwa.
Dijan, maganda kasi naging mas flexible ako eh. I was able to transcend or go through political lines, no? And in fact, yung pagka-independent ko, I was then afforded the opportunity to guest on several presidential Senate slates, no? So I was invited to join Miriam Senate slate, Duterte's Senate slate also, as well as Binay. In fact, I was even considered on Grace's slate, but not officially. And so it afforded me that flexibility. Kumbaga, parang unity candidate din ako. Because we also share similar platforms, similar advocacies. That's why looking forward, whoever the president becomes, we have some common ground. We have some shared ideas on how to put policies forward. We have shared advocacies. That's why kung sinong mananalo, we have some commonalities and we would look forward to working with them.
Thank you, John. From Twitter, uso ang cyberbullying ngayon. Ano po sa tingin niyo ang dapat gawin dito?
Opo, yun talagang tinatakutan ng lahat eh. Miski yung nanay ng mga anak ko, yung asawa ko, nawo-worry din dyan eh. Kaya binabantayan talaga niya eh. So, the cyberbullying really should be curtailed, if not completely, not just discouraged, but we're trying to look at ways how to regulate that without actually infringing on freedom
of expression.
Exactly.
But at the end of the day, sa Facebook, my wall, my space, my thoughts, my truth.
Pero kaya na nga, for children, I think the role of the parents is very important. Kasi habang, while they don't reach the age of adulthood and the level of discernment, kailangan bantayan talaga ng nanay, tatay, yung paggamit ng ano, ng internet at yung Facebook, para hindi na lang magiging ano, biktima ang mga ating anak dyan. Pero bukod pa rin, I think we should have more consultations, no? In the Senate, I think we could also conduct that to bring some light upon it, no? To understand it and how to actually control and to discourage that, no? Kaya at the end of the day, that's the last thing we want, no? That our children will succumb or be victimized. So we're very, very much, you know, aware of it. In fact, even my wife watches over my children's Facebook accounts and regulates their usage of it. Well, they're obviously still young. The eldest is 16, 14. I have an 8-year-old. And
what do they think of your candidacy?
Well, my daughter, ano, is very excited about it because nakikita daw niyang mga poster ko. Eh, 8 years old lang siya, tsaka bibang-biba. My junior was a little bit, ano, worried. Kaya sabi daw niya, Papa, if you run, eh, baka wala ka ng oras para sa atin eh. So, syempre, it was very, but I explained to him, hindi sa kampanya lang yan, pero I always find and make time for them. My eldest, obviously, was very much supportive kasi says, Papa, it's your decision, I'll support it. So, I guess he's a little bit, ano, more, ano, more open to it. I have an 7-month-old daughter, but at the end of the day, I always miss them when I'm on the campaign trail and I wish I had more time with them. But I know that lahat naman ng mga katapusan in terms of this campaign kasi, as you know, a national campaign is very hectic and very grueling in terms of the schedule. So, ngayon po, nami-miss ko na nga sila. Miss mo yung asawa ko, nasa Tacloban. So, I don't see my children as much as I'd want to, but after the campaign, I'll have more time for them, and I hope they'll appreciate that what we were trying to do was to go around the country to spread our advocacy and in the hopes of making, you know, the lives of our fellow Filipinos better through our Malasakit platform.
Pinaliwanag mo ba sa mga anak mo? Why are you running? Siyempre sila unang-unang i-convince mo, di ba?
Yung panganay tsaka yung junior ko, pinaliwanag ko. Kasi yung, ano, yung anak kong babae, basta excited na lang siya na nakita niyang poster
fan
ko.
Fan mode.
O, naka-fan mode eh. Kaya medyo na-excite na nga eh. Iniisip na niya, Papa, what do you do after Senate? Huh? Do you want to run for a higher office? Sabi ko, talo pa yung mga, ano, yung mga commentator dito. Sabi ko, we'll do our best. But yung junior ko tsaka yung panganay ko, siyempre, binaliwanag ko talaga. I said, you know, this is an opportunity for me to serve. And if given the honor to help our fellow, ano, Filipinos in a higher office, it is an opportunity, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And in fact, while the campaign has been very hectic, grueling, I've been telling everyone that had I not decided to run, I would not have seen how beautiful the country really is and how beautiful the Filipinos really are, especially those that I've connected after Yolanda, because through their help, through their generosity, through their malasakit, we were able to bounce back so rapidly, despite the fact that most of everyone after Yolanda wrote us off. Kaya ang dami umalis na lang eh. Lahat nag-evacuate, sabi na, ay, wala na yan. Hindi na makaka-recover yung Tacloban. Hindi na makaka-recover yung distrito mo. But if you go back, you'll be quite surprised that despite all the challenges that we faced, we're bouncing back. But we have to, as they say, work pa more to make the place much, much, even much better. Kasi there's still many needs. Not just proper housing, livelihood opportunities, education, health. We just have to get the community getting or building back better, as they would call it.
Ang kahirapan ay isa sa pangunahing problema na kakaharapin ng sino mang uupong pangulo at siyempre kaakibatan yung mga mauupo sa ano sa Senado through legislation. Maghahanap sila ng mga pamamaraan to address the problem. Kayo, nakita nyo ang mukha ng kahirapan sa Tacloban. Sa paglilibot nyo, meron ba kayong kumbaga parang nakita na ito kahirapan to na dapat i-address din. Ito yung hindi natutugunan talaga ng pamahalaan.
Yung nakikita ko po sa pag-iikot ko, dapat yung distribution ng ating kayamanan through the budget dapat mas maayos. Kaya nakikita ko, hindi masyadong pantay-pantay. Kagaya po ng Visayas at Mindanao, dehadong-dehado. Kaya pinakamaraming na mahirap ay nasa areas natin. And we should also emphasize on creating the regional centers. Para hindi lang dito sa NCR o sa Luzon lang ang development. Kaya we have to encourage regionalization. Kaya na maugong eh. Kaya very popular ngayon si, you know, si Duterte kasi yung sigaw parati, yung federalismo. Eh ano bang federalismo? Eh kumbaga, siyempre nagiging maugong yan kaya sinasabi nila, kaltas na kaltas kayo ng buwis. Pagbalik sa atin in the form of the internal revenue allotment, kulang na kulang, matagal pa bago umabot sa atin. So, there should be a more equitable distribution. Dapat mas pantay-pantay ang distribution ng ating budget. And as a legislator, yun ang trabaho natin. The most important piece of legislation ay yung budget. At ako, I always have this belief, that's why not just for the PWDs, but even in the budget system, there's a saying by President Magsaysay, where people have less in life, they should have more in law. So yung mga mas mahirap sa legislation o sa budget, dapat mas malaki or mas malakas ang suporta. Eh, yung nakikita natin dito, yung mahihirap ay kulang na kulang sa support, just like in our region. But as I see, dito yung sinasabi mong kahirapan, doon po nakikita natin kung saan yung kulang ang ating national budget. Doon talaga ang may underdevelopment at kahirapan. That's why dapat umiikot-ikot lang tayo at titingnan natin talaga kung ano mga critical areas. Kaya po, even with this program that was initiated during the time of the previous administration of President Arroyo, the 4Ps, no? Or the Pantawid Pampamilya, that was introduced, that was like an initial or a pilot program, pinalawakan at pinalaki ni President Aquino. That's to actually help the poorest of the poor, yung pinakamahirap. We want to institutionalize this program para magiging batas na, para magiging karapatan ng mga maradlita. We want to make sure that ilalayo na itong programa, ipalayo natin ito sa palakasan system o yung namumulitika kasi yung mga nakalista dyan po, yung iba ay hindi talaga qualified kay baka malakas lang sila sa kapitan o sa mayor at hindi dapat talaga sila kasali dyan sa programa kasi may mas mahirap sa komunidad. Dapat naman, lininisin natin yan. Pag ginawa natin itong bilang isang batas, we will use the data from what we call the former NSO, which what we call now the Philippine Statistics Authority, that anybody below the poverty level automatically becomes a beneficiary. Bukod pa dyan, we feel that we have to increase the subsidy or the cash grant and not limited na lang to education and health. Pero dagdagan din natin yung nutrition. Kaya karamihan po ng mga...
Or livelihood.
Well, actually, this leads to that. Kaya focus to sa mga kabataan eh. Yung health, education. Pero karamihan po yung mga kabataan na nag-abel ito ng programa, malnourish eh. So we have to increase the cash grant there. Kasama din sa programa to, there should be also a training program para hindi lang yung sinasabi yung mendicancy lang, di ba? Yung parang nalilimos lang. We also have to have a skills or job training or a placement. We have to also have a mindset as a condition. At di ba siya CCT conditional cash transfer? We will get money or a cash grant para sigurado mo na yung anak mo ay mag-aaral. At kung may sakit...
That's the condition.
Yes. And on top of that, dapat kumakain siya ng sapat. na masustansya na pagkain at hinom siya ng gatas. At bukod pa dyan, dapat naman mag-isip-isip din kayo kung paano kayo magtatrabaho para makakagraduate kayo dito sa programa na to. Kasi yung nakita natin ay 20% of our over 100 million Filipinos fall below the poverty level. So, hindi to naman is not to support or to encourage mendicancy or yung paglilimos. But it is almost a stopgap measure. It's an emergency measure to help the poorest of the poor. And of course, we have to do that with the other social programs, as we were talking about earlier, education, health, livelihood, agriculture, industry, kasama na rin yan. Kasama na rin yan. It's a holistic approach. Kumbaga, sabay-sabay yan. Pero yung pinakamahirap, yung namang grabing situation, kumbaga, yung emergency rescue unit, yan ang CCT, yung pantawid. Pero kailangan gawin natin itong batas para it will always be there as a safety net para sa pinakamahirap ng member ng ating lipunan.
At para hindi rin magamit, lalo nating panahon ng eleksyon.
Tama.
Merong question dito, sorry for asking daw, nasan daw po kayo nung nangyari yung Yolanda in a week after the Yolanda incident itself?
2 days before Yolanda, nag-umpisa na yung preemptive cancellation no ng mga commercial flights. So we were already booked on that day, pero na-cancel na yung flight. So we couldn't fly out. The day before the Yolanda, I got a call actually from Secretary Marrojas and asking me to coordinate. Gusto rin ako sumama pero sabi hindi, it's okay, Secretary Bolts and I are going there. Help una us na lang.
Kayo na mauna.
Na sila mauna, pero ako na lang mag-coordinate kasi pagdating daw nila, dapat lahat ng mga lokal, kasama si Mayor Romualdez at yung mga ibang mga mayors, dapat handa na sila mag-meeting. Kasi alam mo naman sa lahat ng mga areas naman, o karamihan po ng areas yung mga politicians ayaw umupo na sabay-sabay kasi yung alam mo yung local politics. Pero sige, Secretary, I'll help coordinate and I'll call all the groups, all the political factions para isang upuan para hindi kayo marapan. So we were able to do that and coordinate for him. And it became a blessing in disguise. Kay, kung kasama din ako dyan, ako biktima. So on the following day, naka-arrange ka na ng flight to go to Tacloban. And before I boarded the flight, hiningi ng ATO, ng CAP, na, Kong, kami na lang sasakay dito kasi yung aeroplano mo, makakalaan pero hindi tayo sigurado kung maayos yung runway kasi walang radyo, walang radar, wala ng communication, yung tower knockout. Can we use your aircraft that you chartered so that we can set up radio communications? Sige, okay, kasi mas importante na they set up the proper communication.
Isa ikaw ang sumakay.
Yes. Mm. So I gave up that first, the first flight. The second flight, kasama na ako. And we were able to bring in already medicines, some relief goods, generators. And we were able to evacuate some of the critically wounded. Mm. And what we ended up doing was we ended up coming in regularly, in and out, bringing in very, very needed goods like medicines, equipment, and of course, volunteers, aid workers, doctors to help out. So I was there on the second day. And I would not stay there at any extended time, but I would be coming in and out on a regular basis. And we would be giving the proper reports. And the next day we would come in again with the aircraft with more medicines because we have a hospital.
More assistance.
Yes, because our hospital was the only hospital that was able to keep itself open for 24/7 throughout the Yolanda catastrophe. Mm-hmm. So we were making sure that our hospital that was serving the needs of the community was also properly stocked with medicines and critical equipments, no? And as we were able to do, we were able to evacuate every day a lot of patients, elderly and children.
Pero tama kayo dun sa sinabi niyo, if I may share, nung nangyari yung Yolanda, I was on the phone, on air, for Radyo Inquirer with Mayor Alfred Romualdez. At a few minutes before nagkaroon ng storm surge, Actually, meron kaming soundbite na, na ano namin na parang paparating yung malaking tubig. Yes. That was the last words sa ino niya. And talagang na-caught namin on air yung kung paano sila nahirapan at parang nag-panic at the time. Kasi they didn't know what was about to happen, syempre, no? And you were helping them from the outside.
Yes. So what we ended up doing was everybody who was in Tacloban, whether you were a Secretary of National Defense, or if you were just a fish market vendor, everybody there ended up becoming a victim because the place was so devastated. Durug na durug ang Tacloban. Ang daming namatay, ang daming nasaktan. Walang natira. Kaya mabuti lang kasi kung ako ay nandun, edi naging victim man na rin ako.
Actually, si Mayor Alfred, victim siya.
lahat. So, yung unang ginawa natin, yung isang staff ko na nga, pinasakay ko sa isang military aircraft, one of the first military aircraft, para magdala siya ng sat phone para magkaroon ka ng communication kasi zero communication within the first day. Wala man sat phone, kung may sat phone man, walang baterya man. So we were able to send on the first day some communications. So we had to apprise ourselves kung sinong buhay o sinong patay kasi ang daming balita na patay na rin si Mayor, yung asawa niya, yung pamilya na nawala na. And just like with almost every family. In fact, again, through the support of many, including the Inquirer, we were able to procure a lot of satellite communication systems na na-installed dyan sa hospital natin. So not only the local community, but also the aid workers from here and abroad were able to use the sat phones as a communication center. And we had many private enterprise quietly, anonymously giving so much. In fact, through our office, we were able to coordinate with the private sector donations over 100 container vans of donated goods, medicines, clothes that we kept bringing in for almost a period of almost 4 months, nonstop, araw-araw yan. At dahil po talaga yung sinasabi nating malasakit ay doon talaga ay nakita natin yung napakagandang ano, ugali na ating mga kapwa ng Pilipino. So we were doing this out of a series of locations here, among which in Makati, we borrowed from Mayor Binay, the Valenzuela Covered Court, and we were able to get a lot of support from many companies using their dump trucks. And in fact, our foundation bought several dump trucks, no? And that's what we used to bring the goods and services. And of course, a lot of people allowed us to use their aircraft, no? Para rescue, and saka to ferry goods, especially medicines, into the city. Kasi alam mo naman yung airport ay naging talagang jam-pack ng mga military aircraft carrying goods and services. So it was a joint effort, and what we did was since the government was already very, very much preoccupied, we were able to tap and to liaise with the private sector here and abroad and to bring them into Tacloban kasi mismo yung mga news agencies kagaya ng CNN, BBC, nag-coordinate lang sa aking tanggapan to bring them in to Tacloban. And in fact, yung sinasabi ko ng inalkila natin ng aircraft, miski United Nations ay yun ang ginamit din nila. So we tried to do as much service to the community, and I'm very glad also that while I was not there on the day of the typhoon, I was very happy because I was able to be of service rather than to be seeking service from everyone, no? And my whole family, including my brother here.
You were placed in a strategic position.
Yes, and there was almost no communication. And people were asking, paano ba to? Even some officials from the Department of Defense were contacting my office kung may communication kay Secretary Gasmin on the day, no, of the typhoon sa afternoon. So nagulat ako. Yung DND at saka yung opisina ni Secretary Mar, there was a call na kung may communications ako kay Secretary. Sabi ko, wala. So sabi ko, ay, delikado to. Kung yung mismong tanggapan niya, walang communication sa
kanila,
grabe talaga to. In fact, I was able, through our contacts in the United States Embassy, I was able to contact the one in charge, no, for the Air Force, no? May yung kaibigan ko. And we requested assistance from the United States government. Naka-standby naman sila, pero walang ano, wala pang official request from the national government. So sabi ko, kung ako na lang magre-request, eh ako naman ang representative, I'm part of the government. So doon ay naging dahilan kung bakit naka-deploy na ang United States yung armed forces nila, yung aircraft carrier group nila, at saka mga aeroplano nila. Kaya talagang lahat talaga ay handang-handa tumulong, pero kailangan din ng konting coordination. So we try to act as that, not just on a coordinating basis, but to actually be there and to talk to all our friends here and even abroad to make sure and facilitate their ingress and egress sa pagpapasok at paglalabas sa Leyte para makakapasok labas yung mga goods and services nila. So we coordinated with the United Nations, we coordinated with the news agencies, with the private sector groups, and we felt that that was the best that we could do under the circumstances because our local governments was actually devastated and our national government was of course also in many ways overwhelmed because they were hoping to have a zero casualty, but the storm was just too strong, and I think everybody was overwhelmed. That's why at the end of the day we just had to cope, and now we have to learn from these lessons.
Listening to you and talking to you, I realized that you value much the experience that you had in the past, the stories, the experiences that compelled you to where you are right now, to run for public office. Ano yung lessons? Ano yung natatandaan nyo? Of course, you still have until Saturday to campaign, pero ano yung mga lessons about or from this campaign na babaunin mo?
Arlene, yung sinabi ko kanina sa mga kasama ko dito, kung hindi ako tumakbo, hindi ko makikita kung gaano kaganda ang Pilipinas at kung gaano kabuti at mabait ang mga Pilipino. That's why hindi ko talaga pwede talikuran ang ating mga kababayan, hindi lang sa region, pero sa mga nakikita ko at na-meet ko ng mga kapwa nating Pilipino sa ibang mga rehiyon na nangangailangan ng tulong. At sila po ay nagbigay ng tulong sa atin nung nakarang Yolanda. At ito po ang oportunidad at pagkataon ko maglingkod po rin sa kanila. Kaya handang-handa ako talaga magsilbi at maglingkod. Kaya yun talagang gusto talaga gawin ko. Sukliin ko po yung ipinamalas nilang malasakit sa atin. Kaya yung lessons learned talaga ay dapat talaga magtulungan tayo, magka-isa-isa tayo. Kaya sino bang tutulong sa Pilipino kung hindi kapwang Pilipino? Sino ang magmalasakit sa Pilipino kung hindi yung mga Pilipino? At yun itong nakita ko, yun ang napakagandang karanasan ko po sa Yolanda. Opo, maraming namatay, maraming nasaktan, maraming nasiraan, nawalang pag-asa. Pero at the end of the day, nakita ko talaga yung malasakit ng Pilipino sa kapwang Pilipino. At yun po ang naging dahilan kung bakit ako ngayon tumatakbong bilang isang senador para maglilingkod ako sa lahat ng tumulong sa atin at lalo na na-meet ko ang mga ibang mga Pilipino na kailangan ng tulong. At gusto ko rin tulungan ko din sila magsilbi at maglingkod sa kanila.
Naniniwala po kami ang malasakit ay hindi mawawala sa ating mga Pilipino. Marami pong salamat sa inyong panahon, Congressman Martin Romualdez.
Maraming salamat, Arlene, sa Inquirer, sa INQ Live, at saka sa lahat na nakikinig at nanonood dito.
Ito po ang INQ Live. Ako po si Arlene de la Cruz. Marami pong salamat sa panahon niyo.